Melinda presents this unabridged recording of Great Australian Rascals, Rogues and Ratbags, Australia's most colourful criminal characters, written and read by Jim Haynes. For Rebecca Kaiser. Si finis bonum est, totum bonum erit. Introduction. Our crime against criminals lies in the fact that we treat them like rascals. Friedrich Nietzsche. It is a fact of life that we tend to sentimentalize and romanticize criminals, especially as time passes. In writing about criminal characters from the past, there is a tendency to concentrate on the personal lives, tragic circumstances and redeeming characteristics of the individual, rather than look at the damage they did to others and the often horrific nature of the acts they committed. The further we go back in history, the more romantic, heroic and legendary these criminals become. For example, it is now far too late to find out what the robber and outlaw Robin Hood was really like, or even if he ever existed. He is, in all probability, just an amalgamation of various renegades who became local heroes by bucking the system and annoying the local authorities, whose job it was to keep law and order. If there ever was a real Robin Hood, he was long ago fictionalized out of existence and replaced in our culture by a mythical cartoon cliché. American culture is littered with examples of criminals being romanticized and hero-worshipped. Clyde Barrow was responsible for the murder of 13 innocent people, but false history and Hollywood have created the romance of Bonnie and Clyde, victims of a cruel and unfair society. Henry McCarty was a ruthless thug who murdered 8 men, some in cold blood. He is remembered as a fictionalized, dashing and daring gunfighter, alias William Bonney, a.k.a. Billy the Kid. McCarty was 21 when he was shot dead by Sheriff Pat Garrett. But Billy the Kid lives on as one of the most ridiculously inaccurately portrayed legends of the West. Here in Australia, we've done a similar thing with Ned Kelly. All the factual evidence tells us that Ned was a self-obsessed thug whose family on both sides were habitual criminals. Far from being a Robin Hood, Ned and his family stole from anyone they could and were the neighbours from hell. Ned was a bully who recklessly endangered many innocent people's lives, murdered in cold blood, and then attempted to justify himself with a pack of lies and garbled nonsense in his jerildery letter. Yet, in less than 150 years, Ned Kelly has become a mythical figure, transformed by filmmakers, writers, and artists who were either misguided or deliberately wished to perpetuate the fictional version of the story into an heroic, legendary freedom fighter and an iconic symbol of the Australian rebel spirit and republicanism. Perhaps the inspiration we derive from the myths is what really counts. Much of our Western culture, or any nation's culture for that matter, is derived from myths and legends, the truth of which is long lost in the mists of time. In our Western Judeo-Christian culture, the stories and myths of ancient Greece, Roman and Norse mythology mix with the Old Testament stories to give us a sense of ourselves and guidelines and references for our beliefs and philosophies. The English language is full of words and phrases that reference that rich mythological mix, and often we cannot distinguish the history from the mythology. In this book, I've attempted to get as close as possible to telling the truth and exposing the mythology in 15 stories concerning criminals from Australia's past. The characters range from the most despicable examples of humanity to those whose courage has to be admired and whose so-called crimes were seemingly unjustly punished. I've grouped the 15 stories under the rather arbitrary headings of rascals, rogues, and ratbags. This is merely based on my personal opinion that the crimes of the rascals are less heinous than those of the rogues, and the motivations of the rascals were less evil than those of the rogues. In the rascals section, there are several quite admirable human beings, two of whom can be called high achievers. None of them was guilty of violent crimes. The rogues are those who I find it hard to admire or forgive. One was a murderer, and another shot and killed a man and had people murdered. The others in the section are, to my mind, among the least likeable characters I've ever written about. Those in the ratbag section are perhaps the most interesting, in that their lives were extraordinarily unusual and their crimes often farcical, even comical in certain cases. In several instances, mental illness and insanity were obviously partly the cause of their abnormal behaviour, and for that they can be pitied. Listeners will quite possibly disagree with my classifications, and that is fine. In preparing this collection, I've switched certain stories from category to category a number of times. Five of the stories have a transported convict as their subject, and I would argue that two of the other stories concern characters who were greatly influenced by their convict heritage. When you realise that more than 162,000 convicted criminals were sent to the colonies of Australia, this is hardly surprising. The population of Sydney in 1850, for example, was 39,000. Over the previous six decades, 80,000 convicts had arrived in the settlement. The percentage of Sydney's residents who were convicts, ex-convicts, or the children of convicts was therefore obviously a substantial majority. The other eight stories, three from the 19th century and five from the 20th century, have a diverse range of dramatis personae. Two of the stories have soldiers who served in World War I as their subject. Then there is the incredibly successful entrepreneur, the obese butcher from Wagga Wagga, the poet and newspaper owner who was tarred and feathered, the celibate Irish Catholic who tried to murder a member of the royal family, a bunch of White Shoe Brigade petty criminals from the Gold Coast, the transgendered wife murderer, and the very famous and much admired Irish-American journalist. Only one of the 15, Tom Scahill, was never officially charged with a crime, yet I find him to be one of the most despicable and dishonest characters in the collection. Most of the 15 have at least some redeeming features, some talents to be admired, or some glimmer deep down in their personality that reveals kindness to their fellow men and women. In some of them, however, these redeeming features and saving graces are massively outweighed, even made insignificant by their crimes, cruelty, lack of respect for their fellow human beings, and often a mind-boggling selfishness and lack of remorse. I've attempted at all costs to avoid fictionalising any of them. I have to confess to the fact that I deplore the modern trend to fictionalise history. I get annoyed by those so-called biographies in which the author assumes to know the thoughts and words spoken often hundreds of years ago by long-dead characters. "Oh, look, Mr. Banks," said Captain Cook, peering through his telescope. "I can see land." Grrr. I'm getting older, crankier, and less tolerant. I know, but that sort of nonsense can only make the history into a farce. If there are written accounts of speeches, diaries, journals, and newspaper reports, we should attempt to use them honestly and try to make an accurate history, always remembering that the accounts we have may be false or inaccurate. We cannot know the thought, spoken words, and motivations of characters from the past unless they themselves have at least put them in writing. If there is doubt, then it is an author's responsibility to say so. It's not hard to say, "Many believe he was attempting to," or "the newspaper stated." Authors are, of course, allowed to have theories and opinions, but they should always make it clear that that is what they are. Authors who put what they believe might have happened into the mouths of dead people are just writing fiction, not history. Here endeth the sermon. I hope my efforts at researching, unravelling and explaining the lives of these criminal characters from Australia's past will provide some insight into the times in which they lived and the reasons why they became the people they were. I hope readers will be enlightened, entertained and at times amused by them. Every one of us has a story, and I hope you find these 15 stories as fascinating and interesting as I did. Part 1. The Rascals. Rascally. Meanly, tricky, or dishonest, often in humorous disparagement, without serious implication. Webster's New International Dictionary, 1929 edition. Self-denial is not a virtue. It is only the effect of prudence on rascality. George Bernard Shaw, Man and Superman, 1903. 1. Mary Bryant, Who Went Home. From whence it is hardly possible for persons to return without permission. The Ones Who Got Away. Escape attempts began as soon as the convicts of the First Fleet came ashore at Sydney Cove. There were no prison bars to contain the 775 convicts, and needless to say, all the efforts of the guards and marines could not possibly prevent cunning or desperate bids for freedom, and there were many. Probably the first man to escape by sea was French-born convict Peter Paris, sentenced to death for burglary in Exeter in 1783 and transported on the Scarborough. French explorer La Perouse was camped at Botany Bay for many weeks after the First Fleet arrived at Sydney Cove, and within days of the convicts being set ashore, escapees began visiting his camp, some seeking asylum or places in his crew. La Perouse told Lieutenant William Dawes, who visited him at Botany Bay, that he turned them all away with scant rations sufficient to get them back to Sydney Cove. La Perouse was a man of his word, but it does seem odd that the French-born Peter Paris disappeared within days of the colony being established, never to be seen or heard from again. My guess is that he died with the rest of the La Perouse expedition after the two ships were wrecked on Vanikoro in the Santa Cruz Islands, some 300 miles, 480 kilometres, north of Vanuatu. Whether La Perouse knew Paris was taken on board or not, who can say? In the earliest days of the settlement, some of the more naive convicts attempted to flee overland and met their death in the bush from starvation or fatal encounters with various indigenous tribes, so it would have quickly become known that the only sane and practical way to escape was by sea. Escape of any kind was highly unlikely to succeed, but life could be grim for the convicts whether they stayed or ran. After all, the whole point of sending convicts to Botany Bay was that the Lords Commissioners of the Treasury knew it was a place from whence it is hardly possible for persons to return without permission. Hardly possible, perhaps, but not entirely impossible. In September 1790, a former seaman and highwayman, John Tarwood, stole a leaky boat from the South Head lookout station and set off for Tahiti with four other convicts. Judge Advocate Collins, in his journal for September of that year, noted, "In the night of the 26th, a desertion of an extraordinary nature took place. Five male convicts conveyed themselves in a small boat called a punt from Rose Hill undiscovered. They then exchanged the punt, which would have been unfit for their purpose, for a boat, though very small and weak, with a mast and sail with which they got out of the harbour. On sending to Rose Hill, people were found who could give an account of their intentions and proceedings, and who knew that they purposed steering for Otaheite. They had each taken provisions for 1 week, their clothes and bedding, 3 iron pots, and some other utensils of that nature. They all came out in the last fleet and took this method of speedily accomplishing their sentences of transportation, which were for the term of their natural lives. The last fleet referred to here is the second fleet, which arrived in June 1790. The convicts involved had only taken 3 months to decide that they didn't like the prospect of spending life sentences in New South Wales. Tahiti is, however, a long way in a leaky boat, and 5 years later, in August 1795, the 4 survivors of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.